just like you have an anatomy, your skeletal system, your circulatory system, muscular system, and all of the rest of that, so too an alpine glacier has an anatomy. Now, not every single alpine glacier is going to have every one of these characteristics, but every alpine glacier will have at least some of these characteristics. And here are the things I would like you to see, know, and be aware of. First of all, although I'm going to use slightly different terminology than what you see on this diagram, the terminology overlaps. And anybody who studies glaciers, if you use the terminology I'm going to give you or the terminology that's on that diagram, this stuff will cross over without any problem. And this is the terminology that I want you to be aware of. I want you to be able to know what the zone of accumulation is, the zone of ablation, what the word ablation means, what the fern line is, where the snout is at, what calving and icebergs are, and what crevasse are. Let's start with the first four of these terms: zone of accumulation, zone of ablation, ablation, and fern line. Okay, so I circled in red accumulation zone and I circled in white ablation zone. Don't worry about the yellow arrow yet. Let's look over on the left-hand side. Notice this is an alpine glacier. It's coming down out of the mountain. And remember, the higher up you go in the troposphere, the colder the temperatures get. Okay? You have to keep that in mind, which means higher up in the mountain, it's going to be colder. Lower down on the mountain, it's going to be warmer. If you look at this diagram carefully, you can see over here on the left-hand side, it says winter gain. Okay? And then there's the word snow with a big arrow down below it, then a medium-sized arrow as you go to the right, and then a smaller arrow, all pointing downwards towards where the glacier is at. This area here is the zone of accumulation, what the diagram is calling the accumulation zone. The zone of accumulation is this. This is the higher part of the glacier. In other words, higher up in the mountains where it's colder. And it's the place where there is a net increase in glacial ice annually, which means the glacier up there at the top is getting bigger because the summer temperatures are cool enough to keep some of the snow that falls during the winter on the glacier, which then melds into glacial ice. Okay? Then, as you go to the right, you can see that on the right-hand side, it says ablation zone circled in white, which I am going to call the zone of ablation. But you can see how these terms overlap with no problem. And if you look carefully at it, you can see towards the bottom right-hand side, you can see it says summer loss. And you see at the very bottom, you have a big arrow pointing out away from the glacier. Then as you go higher up on the glacier, you can see there's a medium-sized arrow pointing out away from the glacier. And then a little further up, you can see there's a smaller arrow. These arrows are indicating the amount of something. Up at the top, where you can see the word snow, there's a large amount of snow coming in here, which means greater gain for the glacier. And then down at the very bottom, where you see that large arrow pointing out, that means there's a lot of glacial ice that's being lost down there. So the arrows are indicating the amount of something that's happening. And the zone of ablation is this. This is the lower part of the glacier. And because of higher temperatures during the summer, this is the place where there is a net loss in glacial ice annually. Now, the word ablation means the loss of glacial ice through melt, evaporation, and sublimation. It is a word that's specific to glaciers. So, what is the yellow line? The yellow line, that yellow arrow, is the fern line. The fern line divides the zone of accumulation from the zone of ablation. In other words, if you're at the tip of that yellow arrow, and you go to the left, the glacier's getting bigger. As you go to the right, the glacier's getting smaller. Take a look at this photograph. You can see where I've written zone of accumulation. Look at how white the glacier is up here on the top of the mountain. Now compare that to where I have zone of ablation. Look at the gray alpine glacier coming down out of the mountain here. Okay, that gray indicates that the glacier is not covered in snow, which means the glacier itself is in direct contact with the atmosphere, which means it is losing mass. Whereas up here in the top of the mountain, where it's zone of accumulation, all of that is fresh snow adding to the size of the glacier. The red arrow points out the place where you transition from that grayer ice of the zone of ablation to the whiter ice, where is the zone of accumulation. So it's a very visual thing. The snout of the glacier is the end of the glacier, which is what the red arrow is pointing at. That's where the glacier terminates, where it comes to an end. And it is along the snout where glaciers calve. I know this is a kind of goofy sounding word, calving, but calving means the loss of glacial ice when glacial ice breaks off the end of the glacier. It's a very common word in glaciology and glacial geomorphology. It means that the glacial ice breaks off. Now, if the glacial ice breaks off and it goes into water, that's what creates an iceberg. Sea ice is frozen salt water. Icebergs are ice that have been calved off of a glacier, which means it's fresh water. And of course, the most famous iceberg, at least probably in the United States and the Western world, happened in 1912. What did it do? Send me an email and tell me. Okay, let's take a look here. So that white arrow is pointing at the snout of that now familiar glacier over Greenland. That's the end of the glacier. And you can see that as it calves, it's going to be calving into the water. And if you look just below the arrow, right in the middle of the arrow, you can see that there's actually an iceberg right next to the coastline there. But I took this picture from 35,000 feet up. And if you look carefully, you can see in the water a number of white dots. Those are icebergs. So you can imagine if you can see them from 35,000 feet up, how big those things must actually be. Crevasse, now this is a French word. The first person to study glaciers and write about them was a French-speaking Swiss scientist from the western part of Switzerland, where of course there are a lot of glaciers in Switzerland. So a lot of the terminology like glacier itself, glacier, this is the French word for glacier, come from French. Crevasse is one of these words. You don't really say crevasses or crevices, because it's French. You know, at the end of the French word, you don't say the end of the word a lot of times. So the plural is crevasse, not crevasses. Crevasse are stress fractures that are formed on the surface of the glacier because of glacial movement. Like right there on the right-hand middle, you could see all of those cracks in the glacial ice. These things in some places, depending on the size of the glacier, can be 200 feet deep. Glaciers are not always the safest thing to go out on. Not only can you slip, but you don't want to fall into a crevasse. And to give you an idea of perspective and how big those crevasses are, if you look over where the yellow arrow is at, that yellow arrow is pointing at a hole that's carved into the glacier. That this is in France, you could pay them, you know, $3 and go inside. Right next to that hole, there's a person standing there, and he is smaller than the hole, which gives you an idea of how big those crevasses are.